Here's two sheep. These sheep look very similar, but there is one difference between them. One of them is a clone, and the other one is not. Can you guess which one is which? Did you make your guesses? The answer is the one on the left. So this is Dolly, the first mammal to ever be cloned. And Dolly was born in July of 1996. She sadly died just a couple years later due to health complications, which raised doubts about how safe cloning is. But we still do it today. It's quite common to see people cloning their own dogs after they've passed away. So to figure out where we're going with this, let's take a look back into the future, back into the past, in the 1920s. Here's two brothers, the Heck brothers. They were part of the Nazi party in Nazi Germany. And they had an idea. They wanted to bring back an extinct species called the aurochs, a species of ox. And they wanted to do this because the aurochs represented the Nazi ideals. It was aggressive, it was wild, and so on. In this, the brothers actually came up with a new concept, de-extinction, also known as resurrection biology if you want to be fancy. De-extinction is simply the process of bringing an extinct species back to life. So there are three ways that scientists go about de-extinction, and the first one is called backbreeding. So this is what the Heck brothers used to bring back the aurochs. And backbreeding is when scientists take individuals with similar traits to the extinct species, and then they breed them together. So now the offspring resembles the extinct species. The problem with this is it doesn't always turn out the way you want it to. So the Heck brothers were going for something like this. Instead, their cow ended up looking a lot more like this. After that somewhat failed yet innovative attempt, we had Dolly, the sheep that was born. And as I mentioned, Dolly is a clone, and this process is done through SCNT, which stands for somatic cell nuclear transfer. Here's a quick breakdown of how that works. We have two cells, cell A and we have cell B. Cell A resembles the extinct species, and cell B is a close relative of that extinct species. We are going to remove the nucleus of cell B, and for those of you who don't know, the nucleus contains the genetic information. So you remove the nucleus of cell B, and you replace it with the nucleus of cell A. So now your cell looks a bit more like this, with it having the same genetic makeup of the extinct species. Then, in 2003, something remarkable happened. The first de-extinction effort was successful, where scientists brought back this Bardo, a goat species. And this Bardo, while it lived for only 7 minutes after being born, it was such an influential discovery that we have made. As humans who have been alive for 0.002% of the existence of the universe, we have brought something that was dead back alive once again. Then we have in 2010 a nonprofit organization called Revive and Restore that was formed. They wanted to bring back the passenger pigeon, which I'm sure some of you have heard of. And today, the biggest and most well-known leader in de-extinction is a biotech company called Colossal. So Colossal is using SCNT, as I mentioned, as well as the third method to go about de-extinction, known as genetic engineering. This is when scientists use CRISPR, a gene editor, in order to change the genetic makeup of the animal and make it resemble the extinct species. So there are three animals that Colossal is looking to bring back, the first of which is the woolly mammoth. The woolly mammoth closely resembles the Asian elephant, which is still alive today. And scientists have even begun to take an area in Siberia called Pleistocene Park, and they've begun to restore it to what it looks like when the woolly mammoth was still alive in preparation for when it's going to be de-extinct. They're also working on the thylacine, also known as the Tasmanian tiger. The Tasmanian tiger was hunted to death in the 1900s and because it ate a lot of the farmers' crops. So they're also seeking to bring back the thylacine. And the third one is the dodo, the infamous poster bird for de-extinction. No one knows when the dodo bird went extinct because back then no one was paying attention. Here are some other animals that scientists are seeking to bring back. Over here we have the quagga, and on that side is the passenger pigeon. And right there in the middle is the gastric breeding frog. And one fun fact about it is that it actually, its offsprings are born with its mouth. So like when it's born, it like comes out of the mouth, which is kind of funny. Okay, now let's talk about the pros and the cons. I'm sure some of you have been wondering, what are the implications if scientists are looking to bring back animals? So one important thing, reason why they're doing it, is because de-extinction can restore ecosystems and the balance that was there before those animals went extinct. Another reason is that it will increase the genetic diversity. So for example, bringing back the thylacine will increase the genetic diversity of the Tasmanian ecosystem. And the final pro is that going about the process of de-extinction will lead to a greater amount of knowledge, and humans love knowledge. So one of the cons of de-extinction is that we need to resurrect hundreds of these animals if we truly want to bring them back. Bringing one or two isn't going to bring back an entire species. We need hundreds of the animals to stay alive. And that brings me to my next point. We need resources. Do we have the habitat for these animals to live? Do we have the food that they want, that they will need to eat? Do we have the resources for them? And the final thing is that de-extinction is not a solution. Sure, we can bring back an animal that was extinct, but what's to say that that animal over there, that that one won't go extinct tomorrow? Here's a quote from Michael Crichton, the creator of Jurassic Park. He passed away on this very day, 15 years ago. The quote goes, "God creates dinosaurs. God kills dinosaurs. God creates man. Man kills God, and man brings back dinosaurs." I'll give you a second to reflect on what this quote means to you. So now, as we delve into the ethics behind de-extinction, it's important to consider our responsibility in all of this. Is de-extinction a moral obligation, a way for us to rectify our wrongs? Or is it simply a distraction for more pressing conservation efforts? I want you to think about what view you look through, what lens you look through about this issue. Because the future of our planet is in our hands, or perhaps in our labs. Thank you.